Hey, this is RJ May, and you're watching Mr. Mario 2011.
Hey, so what is going on, everyone? It is me, Mr. Mario, and yes, I'm doing the Q&A right here. And in case you do not know, I hit 10,000 subscribers recently. I'm very thankful for it. Thank you all very much. And we're past 3 million views now, so that's just, like, mind blown. I just want to say also, if it sounds like there's some more background noise going on, that is because my wall AC thing over there is on. And I normally turn it off during videos. However, my apartment is hot. It's hot outside. And this video is going to be pretty casual for what it is. So I don't feel the need to turn it off. And if you all just, you know, want to deal with like the light hum of the fan in the background, that's cool. But this is how I'm literally going to stay cool in this video. So I had a bunch of questions for the Q&A. I decided to do a Q&A for my 10,000 subscribers. And I've done several of them. Didn't I do one for 1,000? I can't remember. Normally when there's something big that happens on the channel, I do a Q&A, just a big milestone. However, when I did my 5,000 one, I wanted to do a Q&A, and I literally got, like, the amount of questions I got was, like, I could have put them on one hand, and that was the amount of questions I got. Not five, I'm pretty sure it was less than five, which is sad, but I was like, how is it that I got more questions for, like, my 1 or my 2,000 Q&A, but for, like, my 5,000 Q&A, what happened? Did people get less Snoopy or what? Because I know people saw the video. So pretty much on my last video, I said, guys, spam me questions. That's how this Q&A is going to happen. If I don't have questions, I'm not doing a Q&A. It's as simple as that, but I really want to do one. And you all did a fantastic job. Thank you all very much. In fact, you all did such a good job that I didn't feel like I had to throw out any of the questions. I'm answering all of them, if not most of them. I really can't think of any I threw out. And, it's getting to the point, actually. I have a Word document right here. I put it on my tablet, but I wrote everything in a Word document, and I'm going to be doing half of the questions. Well, more than half, technically. So this is going to be a two-part Q&A session. This is going to be part one. Because I figured, you know, I'll do one page, there's two pages on here. I figured I would do one page, second page is incomplete, and I do like to talk a bit, like I'm doing right now, so if I did both of them, there would be a lot of questions, and a lot of time would be taken doing this video. But I decided to do one part, then do the next part. And by the way, if you don't get your question answered in this video, it might be because you just answered it, you asked it later. What I was doing was, the people who asked first, I threw into the queue first. So, if you're one of the later people to ask questions, don't really freak out that your question didn't get answered or anything. It's probably more than likely going to get answered in the next video. So, this is what we're going to be doing, okay? We'll go ahead, just start running down this list. And by the way, I'm drinking coffee while doing this because it's like 2:30 in the afternoon and I'm tired, so. I'm even doing like the emo thing and drinking it black, but I like black coffee, I don't mind. Anyways, let's start going down this thing. So, number one, when do you think the PS4 or Xbox One will be jailbroken? I've gotten this question a few times, and no, it wasn't even what was at first, it was when I think it'll be jailbroken. Honestly, okay, I just want to say this. First off, jailbroken, I'm not really a big fan of that term. Reason being is that many, I feel like I'm like the neckbearded, you know, atheist, hardcore hacker saying this, but many of the casuals, is what I want to say, have started calling this, like, have termed whatever it is jailbreaking. You flash an Xbox, that's jailbreaking it. You JTAG an Xbox, excuse me, that's jailbreaking it. You soft mod a Wii, that's jailbreaking it. No, the term jailbreak originally came from the iPhone. iPhones were jailbroken. The person who created the jailbreak called it a jailbreak. His name is GeoHot. That's his thing. That's his term. That's understandable. The reason why people refer to these console mods as jailbreaks as well is because then GeoHot worked on the PS3 years later, and he called that a PS3 jailbreak. But ever since that happened, everyone coins the term jailbreak, which jailbreak can mean such a big thing. Like, for example, the PlayStation 3, it's called jailbreaking. In the PSP days, that was called custom firmware, or installing a custom firmware. But now everyone even says jailbreak a PSP, so that's just my little thing with it, but don't worry about it, it's all good. Now, when I think they'll be jailbroken, I don't think they're going to be jailbroken or we're going to see, you know, huge homebrew right off the bat. In fact, I think we might see stuff in, optimistically, a year. If not a year, maybe 2 years. Maybe even 3 years. Because, for example, the Xbox 360, I remember, you got to realize that these new systems, Xbox One and PS4, have really, you know, stepped up their game when it comes to security. Because the 360, within 3 months, there was proof of flashed games, copied games being run on flash DVD drives. After that, at one point, I think about a year later, maybe even less than a year later, the King Kong exploit came out, which allowed you to run Linux on the Xbox 360. All that was patched later on, but then, you know, it took, I want to say, another 2 years before the SMC hack came out, which is what we know as JTAG. So it was 2 or 3 years after that. So the 360 took quite a long time. So I think it's natural if these consoles I'm changing my stance, even optimistically, if we see anything within the next 3 years, I'll be surprised. Like the Wii U, for example, we've seen some real-time modding on there, although that's really patched up. We're really not seeing any type of backup things. For example, I actually have this pre-ordered, but the Wii Key U, it is now, by the time this video goes up, it's probably going to be September. That was supposed to come out late July, early August. So that system is also about 2 years old. And I'm sure the security is not as uptight on these other two systems. So honestly, if we see anything in the next 3 years, I'll be optimistic. I'd like to see Hello World first, and then we're going to work on it later. So baby steps, everyone, just baby steps. Now, going on with the next question here. What is your take on motion controls? If they're implemented right, they're awesome. Many of these systems, I don't think, need them. The original Wii, I thought it did it very well, depending on the game, actually. Tiger Woods Golf, awesome. Very fun on the Wii. I actually prefer to play it on the Wii, and I don't even like sports games. Other games, such as there was like Excite Truck or Excite Bike, something like that. I think it was like some Excite Truck type game. Terrible implementation. I hated playing that. When it comes to the PlayStation 3, I hated six axis. I thought it was stupid. The Xbox One, you're playing Dead Rising and you have to like shake the controller to get zombies off you. It's stupid. I don't like it. PlayStation 4, really haven't seen too much with it. Like, the PlayStation 4 and the PlayStation 3, sometimes they do it right. Like, for example, if you play Flower, that game is just so relaxing, it's so fun. And, you know, you actually tilt the controller everywhere to control your little pedals and everything. The wind, that's it. I think they did a good job with that. So, if it's done right, it's awesome. But to me, it's very rarely that I enjoy it and I think it's done right. Now, if this also includes, you know, the PlayStation Eye, the Kinect, things like that, again, it's rare, but if implementation is done correctly, it's awesome. But most of the time, it's done in a train wreck fashion. How did you get into console modding? Well, I actually did a whole video on this before, but essentially, you could find it somewhere on the channel. Just look up like how I got into modding. And that was like 2 years ago when I filmed that video. But anyways, in short, what happened was I've always been, you know, kind of tech person to family and all. And this is when I was a little kid. Like, seriously, my dad taught me control out delete when I was like 4 or 5 years old. And I was just hooked on computers since then. And my thing was always, you know, for example, if I make a copy of a PlayStation 1 game and I put it in my PlayStation and it doesn't work, why doesn't it work? I didn't like just stopping there. That's when I found out about mod chips, things like that. But really what kind of pushed me over the edge with it was there was this one game. This is when I was in like elementary school, so maybe like fourth grade, really. I found about this game called Thrill Kill. It came out on the PS1, and it was this four-player style cage fighter beat-em-up game. Super bloody, and the game was actually finished. However, it was done by, I want to say Paradox Studios created the game. Virgin Interactive was publishing it. Virgin got bought out by EA. This is where my hate for EA came in as well. Virgin got bought out by EA. And then 2 weeks, the game was done. 2 weeks before the game came out, they canceled it. That was it. EA said, we don't want a game this bloody out on store shelves. So they canceled it. So the game became bootlegged all over the place. And it never got officially released or anything. But I found out about this game. I wanted to look more into it. And I was looking into how to get it, you know, how to play it, things like that. And this is when emulators were terrible at the time. So I found out you could either mod your PlayStation 1, put a mod chip in it, or use a boot disc. I ended up getting a boot disc. I was able to get a copy of Thrill Kill off a forum that I was going to. One of the owners there actually supplied me with a copy just because I was a regular on there. But ever since then, kind of just spiraled out of control after that. And it's gone to the point where now, really any system I get, there's been times I will buy systems specifically to mod them. And there are other systems I get where I will get them and mod them as soon as I can, as soon as any type of third-party code release is available. Kind of like the Wii U, for example. Almost immediately after I got it, I end up modding the Wii on there. I knew I could do that, so I'm one of those people, I'll do things like that. PlayStation 4 or Xbox One? My opinion now. Well, I actually have a 6-month check-in on this video. I did a PS4 versus Xbox One my opinion video, and then I did a video six months later, detailing, you know, any updates that I believe, you know, should be made and all that on there. Really, my opinion is still the same on that. What I mean by that is, if you have to ask me, what should I get, Xbox One or PS4, I'm going to tell you, don't get either of the systems, because you should not be asking me what to get. And if you can't decide what to get, if there's no obvious reason to pick one, then you should just wait. Just wait until there is something good, something you really, really want comes out, and then you get it. But I also think that the Wii U is probably the best system out right now, out of the big three, due to the fact that Mario Kart 8 is there and it's awesome. Are you going to pick up an NVIDIA Shield tablet? Probably not. I really don't do mobile gaming at all. I really don't. I don't really play any phone games. I like handhelds, but I don't use handhelds that much. I don't really mess around with tablets at all. Actually, when I got this thing, I loaded it up with a bunch of emulators, and after about a week, I wasn't playing any of them. I use them for work. That's what I do. So, no, I'm probably not going to be picking up an NVIDIA Shield. I mean, I've heard very good things about it. I've seen awesome things with it. I know what it can do. But, like, the Ouya, the Shield, things like that, I just have no interest in them. So, I'm not going to pick up any. How many Xbox 360 consoles have I owned in the past? I have to say it has to be at least 20 or 30 now at this point. And that's not because they kept dying. It's because pretty much what would happen is I would get them for cheap. I would fix them up. I would resell them, give them to friends, things like that. So, you know, it was just kind of an in-and-out process overall, and I would use them for parts. So there were several times I picked up, you know, part systems. But yeah, right now, I want to say, honestly, it's in the double digits of systems that I actually own. I mean, like, I have, like, this one right here. This system, I don't even remember if it works or not. I think I just, like, cheaply reflowed it and then just put it back here. But it's a Xenon, so it's kind of useless. And this is my doorstop for when I want to keep my main door open. So if somebody wants to sneak by my apartment and then just, you know, jack this because it's holding open my door, joke's kind of on them, because I'm pretty sure the system would work for about a week and then red ring on them again. What was my first console? My first console was actually the Xbox. The original Xbox. The Xbox One. The original Xbox One. this is back in 2001. I picked it up on launch, and I was like 8 years old at the time. But what happened was I wanted systems beforehand, and I really wanted the PS2. I actually even got to rent the PS2 for like 5 days. At one point, this is hard to believe, but at one point you could actually rent consoles from Blockbuster. But they put a stop to that because people kept breaking them or people kept swapping out the guts. When you could rent PlayStation 1s from there, people would take them home, gut swap them with broken systems, and take them back. When the PS2 came out, they were $300 a piece. So I think it was like $25 to rent it for like 5 days or something like that. And it was a good deal for what it was, especially since the PS2s were so hard to find at that time. But I remember at one point I asked them, why aren't you renting PS2s anymore? They said people kept breaking them. So this is why we can't have nice things. But no, I really wanted a PS2. Then the Xbox came along, and I was really into computers at the time, as I've always been. So I said, I want to get the Xbox. That's the Microsoft system. So we got that. I didn't have any systems beforehand, even though all my friends did, because my parents thought for the longest time that my, like, video games would rot my mind and, you know, make me stupid and everything like that. But I think I turned out to be a pretty normal, well-adjusted adult. So, joke's on them. Also, now with all this stuff I've learned from game systems and, you know, tinkering with them, things like that, I'm able to help out the family, so it all works out. When do you think you'll add another zero to that subscriber count? And by that, this person means, in case you don't know, when do I think I'm going to hit 100,000? Honestly, I didn't even think it would get up to this point, but every time it increments, like, if you look at it from a year later, I kind of double. Like, for example, I remember when I really got into YouTube, it took me about a year, a little over a year, to get 1,000 subscribers. About a year later, I got 2,000 subscribers. About a year after that, yeah, 2012, 2013. About a year after that, I had about 5,000. A year later, we're here right now, 10,000. So honestly, looking at it, you know, 1 year later, maybe I'll get 20,000. Another year later, maybe I'll get 40,000. Another year later, maybe I'll get 80,000. Who knows? For all I know, I could just stop at this point too. I honestly don't know how big the channel is going to get. So I don't want to jinx myself or anything. I think it's awesome as is, because I never thought I'd get to this point. But honestly, I'll say this, if it keeps growing at the pace it's going right now, and any of the past, you know, the past growths are reflections of what's going to happen, if I'm still doing this, and if YouTube is still viable, and, you know, it's still a really popular website and everything, it could happen within the next 5 years. That could be a realistic approach. Now, here's a few fast questions here. Do you think the new Silent Hill game will be good? Absolutely. I'm thinking it's going to be good. If it sucks, I'm going to be so disappointed. Especially after playing PT. Because that game was just awesome. But you all know how much I love PT. But no, I really, really hope Silent Hills is going to be as astounding as it's supposed to be. Especially since we have Hideo Kojima on there. He's a freaking genius with games. I love the guy. And even the original guy, like Akira something, the guy who did the original scores for Silent Hill, is now asking Hideo Kojima, can I work on Silent Hills with you? So this is shaping up to be... I honestly hope this is one of the best reboots we've ever seen of a series. I really do. That's what I'm hoping for. Now, what is your favorite video game of all time? Grand Theft Auto 3. That is the game that actually got me into video games. I was hanging out with my cousin, took me over to someone's house. They sat me down in front of a TV, had me play Grand Theft Auto 3. Terrible for an 8-year-old, but that is the game that got me into games. And to this day, still my all-time favorite game. Still my all-time favorite game. I absolutely love it. Yes, I love it even more than any of the other Grand Theft Auto games. None of the other Grand Theft Auto games have kind of come in comparison to this. Grand Theft Auto 5 is close, but like, Grand Theft Auto 3 is right here for me, and Grand Theft Auto 5 is like right here as like ranking the best Grand Theft Autos. So Grand Theft Auto 3 is still reigning champion for me. What is your favorite genre of games? Honestly, I don't really think I have a favorite genre. I really like shooters. I like RPGs. Fighters, I used to be good at, now I'm terrible at them. Racing games are fun as well. I really try and, you know, dip my hand into everything. I used to have a few, it's kind of like music. Like, sometimes I'll have a favorite genre. Maybe for, like, 6 months, I'll like racers. Maybe for 2 years, I'll really like shooters. But it always changes. So, I really don't have a favorite genre. I just try and play everything I can. Now, here's a good question. What do video games lack today? This one has to make me think a little bit. Honestly, I think video games really lack that allure that they used to have. Like, for example, you could take a video game, show it to someone who really doesn't know that much about gaming, and they don't think it's a nerdy thing. They think it's something amazing, something spectacular. And now video games are such, you know, carbon copies of each other. A friend and I have had long conversations about this, but Call of Duty 4, for example, that's my all-time multiplayer shooter. Like, my all-time favorite multiplayer shooter. We believe that Call of Duty 4... Yeah, I've just had to check something with my mic. We believe that Call of Duty 4 is the best worst game to really ever happen. Reason being is that Call of Duty 4 brought some very innovative, super awesome things to the table at the time in 2007. However, after Call of Duty 4 came out, every other multiplayer shooter that came out on the market tried to be Call of Duty 4. Even Call of Duty tried to be Call of Duty. Like, Call of Duty copied itself multiple times over. Call of Duty 4 was probably the freshest breath of air in the Call of Duty genre. Well, yeah, you know what? No, Call of Duty genre, that's it. It has its own thing, because that is just Call of Duty right there. But, no, even with it, like, that's my all-time favorite with that one there. But I think they really lack that original lore they have, and that is why, you know, like PT, for example, just a few weeks ago, I was freaking out about it, because it was something fresh, it was something new, it was something mysterious that, you know, a lot of people couldn't just, you know, rip open and, you know, guess what was going to happen. Like, it took people weeks to figure out how to properly beat the game. I haven't touched it again because I got kind of frustrated with it, I'm not going to lie. But now there is, like, a 100% surefire way to beat the game. It took people weeks to do it. You had people, the person who found it, actually, he bought a PS4 just for PT. Just for PT. This free demo out there for a game that doesn't exist. It's stuff like that that is missing now, unfortunately, which... it's kind of disappointing to see, but I think just they don't have as much of a big splash or an allure as they used to have. Now, here's some personal questions here, which I said, you know, these are up for grabs as well, because I'm the one who chooses, you know, if I want to answer them or not. But how well did he do in high school? I want to say I graduated with over 3.5. It was like a 3.56, I want to say specifically, for my GPA, which I could have done better, but honestly, there were a few classes I was lazy in, so I got Bs instead of As. And calculus and I do not get along. At all. We don't. No. Let's see. There was one class, like, freshman year. I don't know what was up with it, but I was just doing terrible in there. I got a C in the class. Like, for me, a C or lower is bad. But, normally I try and get at least a B in a class, because that's average to me. But, normally, mostly A's, a few B's, but then, like, I got, like, for some world history class, I think, I got a C in there. I just did not like the flow of the class. I didn't. And then, pre-calculus... and calculus A and B. No, I got C's in those ones. I tried as hard as I could. No, I couldn't do it. Even when I came to college, those were the only classes I consistently got C's in. Because any other math, up until calc, I can do just well, I'm confident with. When it comes to calculus, no. And people say, you know, try as hard as you can in it, you know, you just keep practicing. I'll tell you this, I took 2.5 years of calculus, I never got higher than a C. But I also never got lower than a C, so I guess that's kind of good. Do you plan on living in the Midwest your entire life? I'm willing to go wherever, honestly. In case you don't know, I've lived in Kansas most of my life. I was actually born in Washington, D.C., but then, you know, when I was a few months old, parents moved down here. But I've been in Kansas most of my life. Recently, I moved up to Illinois for 3 months because of an internship, which is still in the Midwest, and I would love to get out of the Midwest, for sure. I don't hate it, but I just want to see other things, you know? So, honestly, wherever my job takes me, whenever I, you know, sign that big contract and everything, I'd be willing to go wherever. I'd love to go down to Texas. I'd love to go to California. Maybe even back over to the East Coast, but I have to say, I kind of like the West Coast a bit more. I went to California a few years ago, and awesome trip. Well, phew, that was when I was like a kid, but awesome trip. And California has everything, like everything there is awesome, is what it seems like. You all had the Terminator as a governor. You all had Tupac, and pretty much when it comes to rap, I favor West Coast over East Coast. So if I could move out more to the east, that'd be awesome. But at the same time, I also kind of want to move somewhere where it's not as hot because I hate the heat. So maybe California isn't the most viable option. But, you know, wherever my jobs takes me, wherever life takes me, I'll go. Will you play Call of Duty? I have to take coffee for this. I'll put it like this. Outside of Call of Duty 4, I really don't like Call of Duty. I've played all the Call of Duty games up until Ghosts. Ghosts was the first Call of Duty game in years that I did not beat because it was so bad. And the multiplayer was terrible and Extinction was pretty whack. But no, I said before, I will never do Call of Duty commentaries on this channel. Occasionally you might see me on a Call of Duty game. Maybe I'll get on like, I don't know, original Black Ops for 10 minutes. Maybe I'll get on Modern Warfare 2 for 20 minutes. Maybe I'll get on Call of Duty 4 for an hour. But aside from that, no, I'm not going to show Call of Duty on this channel. I have one Call of Duty video, actually, I've shown. Just one. You have to find it. But no, more than likely, it's going to be rare for you to find me playing Call of Duty. What's your favorite food? Pizza. Easy. Easy. One-word answer. That's all it is. Pizza. It's been like that since I was in, like, elementary school. I'm good on that. What race are you? Well, I guess technically I would be white and Asian. But if you want to put, you know, like if you want to go into detail with it, I'm weird. I'm half Palestinian and then a quarter German. So that's where the white comes from. Some people are going to try and say, you know, Arab is its own race. No, it's not. We're white. And then I'm a quarter Japanese. So I'm all mixed up with all that. But yeah, that's why it's like I look normal, but not really normal at the same time. So I have a whole bunch of stuff going on, I guess. I don't know. It's interesting to talk about, but I'm just a weird mix of everything. Like, just, I haven't heard that mix before, to be honest. I met, like, maybe the closest I've gotten is, like, I've met, like, one other person whose name was Danny, who is also a quarter Japanese, which is kind of just, like, how does this happen? Especially since we had, like, all the same classes together, but aside from that, no, I really haven't met anyone that kind of matches up to that. Taco or burrito? This is a good one. It depends on what it is, you know? Some days I'll prefer tacos, sometimes I'll prefer burritos. When it comes to the majority, though, most of the time, I go with burritos. But it depends on what you're getting. Like, do you want to go to Taco Bell at 1:30 in the morning and get, like, a really crappy Taco Bell burrito? Or do you want to talk about, like, a Chipotle burrito? Or do you want to go to, you know, down to Mexico and go one of those stands and get a burrito for, like, 25 cents that's, like, an authentic burrito? I think that kind of answered itself, though. I will go with burritos more. But if someone gives me a taco, I'll eat a taco. I don't have any issues with that. What are you currently studying in college? I'm currently doing management information systems. That is like my surefire major. That is what I want to do. In case you don't know, for about a year and a half, I started college in August of 2011. And I want to say about less than a year and a half in, because it was late 2012 when I started my third semester, I decided computer science, the major I was in, was not for me at all. I was miserable. I was enjoying what I was doing. I wasn't good at what I was doing. There's some people that say, well, you know, you don't have to enjoy it, but if you're good at it, stay at it. No, the problem was I wasn't good at it and I wasn't enjoying it at all. And also it even got to the point, it's like when I was saying I wasn't good, I'm talking like my GPA was dropping in huge increments. So it was like one of the first times in my life I didn't know if there was something wrong with me, because I'm like, do I have ADD or what? Because I know I'm not that smart, but I'm also not, you know, completely stupid at the same time. So I don't think my GPA should be this low. But no, I decided to go because I was in the College of Engineering. I went to the College of Business, went in Management Information Systems, and started excelling in that. And I absolutely love it far more than computer science, for sure. I have a newfound respect for coders, though. You all are awesome, especially since I can't code worth a damn. But yeah, no, it's Management Information Systems. That's definitely the way to go for me. I'm loving it. And the reason why I'm also talking about this a little bit is if you're not happy with your major, do something about it, change it, because you can learn to be good at something, but you can't learn how to love it. Like, that's just how it is. If you go into it hating it and you still hate it a year later, you're still going to hate it 5 years later. Now, this is kind of an interesting question, but I feel like the answer's gonna be, you know, not really as big or secretive as people want it to be. What are the first techniques you relied on to start growing your channel? Do you just make cool content and hope people would recognize it? Or did you have some sort of YouTube marketing tricks up your sleeve? Well, my sleeves are pretty short, so I don't really have any tricks up there. But no, there's really two things. One, I just made content I wanted to make. And thankfully, it latched on and people really enjoyed it. But there was also a niche for it. There was a market for it. For example, a lot of people want to be Let's Players. I think Let's Plays are cool. I think they're awesome. The problem is, so many people do them. And so many people try and copy off each other. If you try and copy off PewDiePie, more than likely you're not as cool or entertaining as him. I'm not saying I really like PewDiePie, I'm not a fan of him, but I'm using this as an example. If you try and be like PewDiePie, but you're not as good, and it's only costing me time to watch videos, why would I watch you over PewDiePie? That's kind of how Let's Plays are. For me, I more got into the modding side of things, and I was doing, you know, drive mods and how to, you know, patch your ISOs, things like that. Things that just were not being made into videos, or they weren't being made into proper videos, or they were scams, or they were outdated. So I came in with that, and people loved it, and then I started kind of branching off that, and people still liked it. And the people that hated it, they left, and the people that liked it, they stayed, and then more people came onto the channel, and more people came on. Maybe the only trick I used, which this isn't even a trick, is it's always good to tag your videos properly, to name them properly, to have good descriptions, things like that. You don't need to use any shady tactics, you all. You don't. In fact, I highly advise against it. But search engine optimization is your friend. Keep that in mind. Can you buy me a PS4? To be honest, I wasn't going to answer this, but I actually thought of something. Here's the deal to whoever said that. If you go out and you buy me an NVIDIA GTX 980 when it comes out, I will buy you a PS4. I think that's a fair trade-off. What are your thoughts on free-to-play games? Well, I'll be honest, I don't really play too many free-to-play games, so I don't think I'm very qualified to, you know, answer this, but for the sake of the Q&A, I'll answer it anyways. Again, it's all about implementation. If it's done correctly, sure. Like, if I say free-to-play games suck, well, look at, Overload? Or, no, Loadout, that game. Look at Loadout, very successful game. Look at Team Fortress 2, one of the best multiplayer shooters out on the market. And you know how much it costs to get? $0. You know how much it costs for upgrades? $0. And when I say upgrades, I'm talking about gun upgrades, XP, things like that. Things that actually help you in the game. Because the only things you can buy are cosmetic. For example, if I buy this shirt, it's not going to make me better in-game. It's just going to make me look cooler. But that is the type of free-to-play stuff I like. However, free-to-play games like Candy Crush, no, it's not really that entertaining of a game. And the company has done so much shady stuff. And there's a lot of bad apples out there, but there's some, you know, really shining titles that deserve praise. Team Fortress 2, as I said, excellent implementation of that. And there's other games like the number one most live stream, most popular game in the world right now is free. League of Legends, free game. People make livings off that. And Dota 2, it was paid for at one point, but paid for. By that, I mean it was like $20 at one point, but people were giving out so many free keys that if you paid for it, you were kind of slow in the head. But now it's completely free. So free games definitely taking over. But if it's like crap free-to-play or spammy free-to-play, it's not good at all. Not good. That's what's killing the industry. But that's mostly the stuff you're going to find on Facebook, like Candy Crush and Farmville, things like that, which I don't even count those as games. So I guess free-to-play, as I said, if implementation is done correctly, I'm all for it. Do you think current-gen consoles, the PS4, the Wii U, and the Xbox One, is what he's talking about here, aren't powered enough to keep up with the coming years. So, in other words, do I think they're future-proofed? I think they're fine, to be honest. A lot of people got bad taste in their mouths with these consoles, the last-gen consoles, according to this guy. So the 360, the PS3, and the Wii. But that generation had lasted for so long, it lasted for an abnormally long amount of time. But this generation, I don't think it's going to last as long. I would say we get maybe 5-6 years out of it. Although Sony seems to be, you know, very sure that they want to do their 10-year program. And by that I mean, ever since the PS3 came out, they said we are going to dedicate ourselves to keep our systems going for at least 10 years. I want to say they supported, thinking about it, no, they supported all their systems for 10 years. The PlayStation, the PlayStation 2, the PlayStation 3, the PlayStation, not PlayStation 4 yet, but and not even the PS3 yet. It hasn't been 10 years, has it? But no, the PSP, they supported for 10 years. No, the PSP, it hasn't been out for 10 years either. That came out in 2005. What I'm trying to say is Sony has a 10-year plan. I hope they stick to it. But I feel like we're going to see new iterations of the consoles maybe in about 5 or 6 years. What is my most anticipated game? To be honest, there's really nothing I'm anticipating. I mean, Destiny is literally right around the corner. Like, let me bring up my map. Not my map. It's not coming out this week. Next week, Destiny is coming out. I can't believe that. Unless I got it wrong. Is it coming out the second? I really don't know. If it's not coming out this week, it's coming out next week, which I remember Destiny was way far off. But honestly, I'm not even really anticipating it. I know it's a good game. I'm more than likely going to enjoy it. But there's really nothing out that has gripped me or enticed me or anything like that, to be honest. So, kind of a disappointing answer, I understand. But there's just really nothing out there that I'm looking forward to completely. Master Chief Collection, that would be cool. But I can live without it, as I said. Halo 5, the reason... I think there's a release date on there. I think so. I mean, Halo 5, sure, anticipated, but... When I say anticipated, I'm thinking of, like, something I'm completely freaking out over, I'm super happy about. Like, Grand Theft Auto 5, I was heavily anticipating that. A bunch of other games out? Not really. I mean, when they come out, I guess. But, yeah, I'm sorry to disappoint you on that. There's really nothing I'm anticipating at the moment. Who is your favorite rapper? Well, I have several. I'll say this. I got on a large, you know, 80s, 90s rap kick this summer. And I always believed Tupac was one of the greatest, but I have to say, greatest of all time, it has to be Tupac Shakur. The reason why I'm saying that is, for some people, because I know there's several younger people on here who might not have listened to Tupac that much, do yourself a favor. Go out and listen to All Eyes on Me by Tupac. That album was mind-blowing, because I just want to go on this whole spiel about it, okay? Because this guy was awesome. And there's even, like, there's so much backstory you go on to with him as well, with all the conspiracies that happened against him. But pretty much in 1996, that was the last year he was alive, he released this album, All Eyes on Me. It sold like 10 million albums, I think. Something insane like that. It was the first rap double album to come out. One of the best albums ever to come out. If you listen to it now, it still sounds like a brand new album. They did an insane job mastering it, producing, everything like that. Insane. And even the topics that he talks about and raps about are still relevant today. Same as they were back in 96. He was huge in the 90s, but he was still even ahead of his time, which was the crazy thing to see. But no, honestly, one of the best albums you will listen to. An insanely good album. But that's not even my favorite. No, he did the All Eyes on Me thing, went all out with it. And then, after that, he went on tour. He came back within a week. He made Machiavelli. He had this whole new alias, which was Machiavelli. And then he did Don Illuminati, the 7-Day Theory. They call it the 7-Day Theory because I want to say he wrote all the lyrics in like a day. Or no, within like 3 or 4 days, he wrote and recorded everything. And they spent the rest of the week mastering it. And then he died before it came out. But that is my favorite album, actually. His last one that he ever made. There's been several posthumous albums that have come out. But I don't really like to count them as albums because they... He lived in the studio. He did. And that's one thing about him. He has made so much content. The few years that he was active, he's made more content than several rappers have in 20 years. So I have mad respect for the guy, for sure. But no, as for rappers who are alive right now, I want to say Logic, definitely love him for sure. Awesome guy. You know, Eminem, always great. People were disappointed by Marshall Mathers too. I went into it knowing what to expect. I knew that his Slim Shady persona was never going to fully come back. Slim Shady, when he was originally, you know, in the whole Slim Shady phase, he was screwed up in the head. He was. He had a lot of issues going on, personal and public. He was very screwed up in the head. He was completely doped up. Now his job is to be a dad. But he came back and decided to rap anyways, and I think he's pretty good at it. So Eminem is also great. I actually had to bust my phone out to see what I've been listening to recently, but I've been listening to a little bit of Pusha T. Like, all this morning, I've been listening to Flatbush Zombies, so they've been awesome. Get their mixtape, Better Off Dead. It's awesome. Let's see what else is here. Schoolboy Q, always great. Anything produced by Harry Fraud, I'm normally going to listen to. And then I was even doing, you know, a bunch of Chopped and Screwed stuff and everything, so pretty much a lot of DJ Screw things like that. Earl Sweatshirt, Kanye West. Earl Sweatshirt, you know, I'm not a big Tyler the Creator fan. I understand what he does. I appreciate it. I'm just not a big fan, though. But Earl Sweatshirt, I think he's awesome. But that's enough with the phone over there. But yeah, no, I don't really have. I always cycle through my favorite rappers, so I really don't have one. But I guess right now, the huge kick has been Tupac. So I don't. Is he going to be my favorite in a year? I'm not 100% sure. But will I acknowledge he's the greatest of all time? Yes, in my opinion, he is, for sure. I also throw Biggie in there. Actually, the more I've been listening to Biggie, the more I've liked him. But I still don't think he ranks up as high as Tupac. Now, last question for this Q&A, at least. And then I'm going to talk about some Q&A stuff for a little bit. I think this one's pretty funny, too, to end it off. Why do people, Americans is what he's referring to, think that people from Dubai are rich? Not all of us are rich. Me, for example. And then he put a really big smiley face there. Well, see, I hate to tell you, but the reason why we all think you are rich is because you all are rich! Give us some money! No, seriously though, when you see some crazy stuff going on in Dubai, like, for example, not even crazy stuff as in, like, bad stuff, but, like, didn't they have, like, the world's, like, only, like, 7-star hotel for a while? It was something like that. You see the amazing, beautiful infrastructure of the city. It's a very high-tech city. It's known for shopping. You just look up Dubai. Look, do yourself a favor, whoever asked this, but other people too. Look up Dubai, see all the beautiful, amazing pictures of it, and then you'll be like, oh, that's why they think we're rich. No, it's amazing infrastructure, but I can kind of see it from the same way. Like, for example, I'm sure there's foreigners who think that everyone in New York is rich. That's not true. There's, you know, a lot of homeless people there, a lot of, you know, people in poverty. But no, that's pretty much why. Because it looks like everyone's rich. Because of the infrastructure, because of how everything is set up, and because of the awesome stuff you all have. So, good job. Now that the tablet is closed, that is the end of this Q&A. I am going to be doing a part 2 where I'll be answering the rest of the questions. However, if you've made it all the way to the end of this Q&A, and you did not know I was doing a Q&A, or you suddenly thought of a question you want to ask me, I'm giving you one more shot. I'm going to be saying it like this, same rules as before. If you want to ask me a question, I'm not going to be saying usernames because, as I said, some people might not want to be outed, and other people, I just don't want to use it as like a promotion tool for them or anything like that. Don't want anyone to take advantage of it. But if you have a question for me or questions, post them down below on this video as comments. If I don't reply to them, it is because I'm probably going to be using them as Q&A questions. Or if you don't want other people to know what you're asking me, go to my YouTube channel, message me on there, send me a private message, and say, this is for the Q&A, and ask me whatever questions you want to. And more than likely, if I get them within the next few days, I'll drop them into the next Q&A. Granted, if I feel like they are, you know, Q&A appropriate, and if I feel like I should answer them. There are a few questions, technically, I did not answer, because there were several repeat questions, so that's why there were some I didn't answer, but they're going to get answered anyways. Anyways, this is Mr. Mario, signing off. Thank you for watching, everyone. I really appreciate the support, you all. It's been amazing, and more than likely next weekend sometime, I'm going to try and knock out the second Q&A. But thank you for watching, everyone. Thank you for 3 million views. And thank you so much for 10,000 subscribers. I'll see you all later.